So students, we are discussing colligative properties. Last lecture we have seen about colligative properties, that is what are colligative properties, and now we are going to see depression in freezing point. First colligative property we saw lowering of vapor pressure. Next colligative property we saw elevation in boiling point, and now we are going to see depression in freezing point. What is depression in freezing point? Depression means lowering. When something gets lowered, when something comes down, that is called as depression in freezing point. So before that, we are going to see what exactly is freezing point. Freezing point is temperature at which liquid and solid are in equilibrium and the two phases have same vapor pressure. Temperature at which liquid and solid are in equilibrium, because freezing exactly is nothing but liquid getting converted to solid. So this is called as freezing. So temperature at which liquid and solid are in equilibrium and the two phases have same vapor pressure. Freezing point of a solvent is lowered by dissolving a non-volatile solute into it. What exactly our point, that is depression in freezing point, is freezing point of a solvent is lowered by dissolving a non-volatile solute in it. If T0F is the freezing point of pure solvent and TF that of the solution in which non-volatile solute is dissolved, then T0F is greater than TF. The difference between the freezing point of pure solvent and that of the solution is depression in freezing point. Thus we have delta TF, which is equal to T0F minus TF. Now see properly, freezing point depression as a consequence of vapor pressure lowering. Here you can see vapor pressure temperature curve. That is vapor pressure and temperature are, vapor pressure is on the y-axis and temperature is on the x-axis. So here you can see that is there are almost three curves. One amongst them is approximately equal to a straight line. EF curve, CD curve and AB curve. Here you can see this. Now if you see properly, here the diagram consists of three curves. Okay. I'll show you properly again the curve so that you all can understand properly. Now see here, in case we have three curves, that is a CD curve, EF curve and AB curve. AB is the vapor pressure curve of solid solvent, while CD is the vapor pressure curve of pure liquid solvent, and EF is the vapor pressure curve of solution. Now EF always lies below BD, or CD you can see. It always lies below. It is important to note this, that now the curves AB and CD intersect at point B. See now, curves AB, AB and curves CD, they intersect at point B, while where solid and liquid phases of pure solvent are in equilibrium. The two phases have same vapor pressure at B. The temperature curve to B is freezing point of solvent, that is TF. So T0F is the vapor is the temperature of freezing temperature, you can say, of pure solvent. Similarly, at E, the point of intersection of EF and AB, the solid solvent and solution are in equilibrium. They have same vapor pressure at E. The temperature corresponding to E is the freezing point of solution, that is TF. I'll repeat again, curves AB and CD intersect at point B, where solid and liquid phases of pure solvent are in equilibrium. Curves, you can see again on the screen, curves AB and CD intersect at point B, where solid and liquid phases of pure solvent are in equilibrium. The two phases have same vapor pressure at B. The temperature corresponding to B is the freezing point of solvent, that is T0F. Similarly, at E, the point of intersection of EF and AB, the solid solvent and solution are in equilibrium. They have same vapor pressure at E. The temperature corresponding to E is the freezing point of solution TF. So it is clear from this figure that freezing point of solution TF is lower than that of pure solvent T0F. It is obvious because the vapor pressure curve of solution lies below that of the solvent. Because it lies below, you can see that there is depression, or that there is lowering. Fine, you can see over here. Now a question may come in your mind, that why freezing point of solvent is lowered by dissolving a non-volatile solute into it. What exactly happens? Why it is lowered? Now, at freezing point of pure solvent, the attractive forces amongst the molecules are large enough to cause the change of phase from liquid to solid. In a solution, the solvent molecules are separated from each other because of solute molecules. Such separation of solvent molecules in solution is more than that in pure solvent. This results in decrease in the attractive forces between solvent molecules. Consequently, the temperature of the solution is lowered below the freezing point of solvent to cause phase change. In case of pure solvent, you can see that there is attractive forces between the solvent molecules. Whereas in case of solution, you can see between the solvent molecules, there are also solute molecules present. So therefore, attractive forces between them is decreased. And as a result of which, again I'll repeat, in a solution, the solvent molecules are separated from each other because of solute molecules. Thus, the separation of solvent molecules in a solution is more than that in the pure solvent. This results in decreasing the attractive forces. The force of attraction between them is decreased between the solvent molecules. And consequently, what will happen? The temperature of solution is lowered below the freezing point of the solvent to cause the phase change. Now, what freezing point, depression and concentration of solute? That we are going to see. How it is related to concentration. Delta Tf is directly proportional to m, that is molality, same as we have seen in case of delta Tb. So delta Tf is directly proportional to m, or delta Tf is equal to Kf into m. What is Kf? Kf is now here, it is proportionality constant, or it is also called as freezing point depression constant, or it is also called as cryoscopic constant. Same case if you see delta Tf is equal to Kf when molality is equal to 1. If we replace molality by 1, we can say that delta Tf is equal to Kf. The cryoscopic constant thus is the depression and freezing point produced by 1 molal solution of a non-volatile solute. Unit of Kf. When you go for unit of Kf, you can say delta Tf divided by m, which is equal to, now what will be the unit of Tf? Tf will be in degree Celsius or it will be in Kelvin. So therefore, degree Celsius or Kelvin divided by molality, that is mole per kg. So that will be K kg per mole, or degree Celsius kg per mole. K is Kelvin. Now, molar mass of solute from freezing point depression. Now we are going to see molar mass of solute from freezing point depression. Delta Tf is directly proportional to m, that is molality. Delta Tf is equal to Kf into m. Now molality, that is m, which is equal to 1000 into W2 divided by M2 into W1. We have seen this in previous lecture. Delta Tf is equal to Kf, just substituting in the above equation, mathematically you can see delta Tf is equal to Kf into 1000 into W2 divided by M2 upon W1. Hence we have M2 is equal to 1000 into Kf into W2 divided by delta Tf into W1. So delta M2 is equal to what? M2 is equal to 1000 into Kf into W2 divided by delta Tf into W1. Now this you can see that molar mass of solute from freezing point depression. So therefore, this colligative property, that is delta Tf, it depends upon molar mass of solute. And as it depends upon molar mass of solute, you can see that it is a colligative property. Because colligative property, it depends only on number and not on their nature. As it depends upon the number of moles or as it depends upon molar mass, you can say that it is a colligative property. Next case, when you see osmotic pressure. Last colligative property, we are going to see osmotic pressure. In osmotic pressure, we are going to see certain concepts now. The very first is semi-permeable membrane. Semi means half. Half permeable, or it allows only half. What is that? Now, osmotic pressure phenomenon involves the use of semi-permeable membrane. Semi-permeable membrane can be naturally occurring or they can be synthetic. So, what exactly is semi-permeable membrane? It is a film such as cellophane, which has pores large enough to allow the solvent molecules to pass through them. These pores are small enough not to allow the passage of large solute molecules or ions of high molecular mass through them. Semi-permeable membrane selectively allows the passage of solvent molecules. So it is, you can say that it is a membrane which allows only the passage of solvent molecules and not the solute molecules. So this is called as a semi-permeable membrane. So next you can see over here in this diagram, you can see properly that we have a large beaker or a large vessel, you can say. And in this large vessel, we have made two compartments. And in both cases, we have separated them by a semi-permeable membrane. In the diagram, you can see that we have separated them with the help of semi-permeable membrane. In one compartment, we have taken only solvent molecules, and in the another, we have taken solution. Fine. Now, what will happen? You can see the nature of flow, or the you can see the direction of flow. That is from solvent to the solution. Because semi-permeable membrane will allow only the solvent molecules to pass through them and not the solute molecules to pass. Same case here, it is not only applicable to only solvent and solution, but two solutions which are of different concentrations. For example, if one is a very dilute solution and another is a concentrated solution. So what will happen here? Solution of lower concentration and solution of higher concentration, when they are separated by a semi-permeable membrane. Both solutions are separated by a semi-permeable membrane. The net flow will take place from lower concentration to a higher concentration. So this is called as this is the work of semi-permeable membrane, and from this we have one concept that is called as osmosis. What exactly it is? See the definition. Net, spontaneous flow of solvent molecules into the solution or from more dilute solution to more concentrated solution through a semi-permeable membrane. Always it takes place from a dilute to concentrated. It's not from concentrated to dilute. It is from dilute to concentrated and through a semi-permeable membrane. Always it takes place via semi-permeable membrane, and this is called as osmosis. Semi-permeable membrane. Now here you can see in the diagram, you can see for you all to understand osmotic pressure. What exactly is osmotic pressure? Semi-permeable membrane is fastened across the mouth of a thistle tube. The solution of interest is placed inside the inverted thistle tube. This part of the tube and the membrane are then immersed in a container of pure water. So solvent is taken outside and some solution, let's take sugar solution, is immersed in the thistle tube or in the thistle funnel, and the thistle funnel is inverted and the open end of the thistle funnel is closed with the help of a semi-permeable membrane. And you all know what is the work of semi-permeable membrane? To allow only solvent molecules and not the solute molecules. So naturally what will happen? As a result, some of the solvent molecules, they pass through the membrane into the solution. This causes the liquid level in the tube to rise. The liquid column in the tube creates hydrostatic pressure that pushes the solvent back through the membrane into the container. The column of the liquid in the tube continues to rise and eventually it stops rising. At this stage, the hydrostatic pressure developed is sufficient to force solvent molecules back through the membrane into the container at the same rate they enter into the solution. So here you can see a time will come due to osmosis. Initially, the solvent molecules will pass into the thistle tube or into the thistle funnel through the semi-permeable membrane. This is first case. So also a hydrostatic pressure is developed from the liquid inside the thistle funnel, and that will create a pressure, and because of which the molecules which are coming in will go out. Now see this. At this stage, a hydrostatic pressure is developed and it is sufficient to force the solvent molecules back through the membrane into the container at the same rate and they enter the solution. An equilibrium is thus established where rates of forward and reverse passages are equal. The height of the liquid column in the tube remains constant. This implies that hydrostatic pressure has stopped osmosis. Now what is this hydrostatic pressure? The hydrostatic pressure that stops osmosis is an osmotic pressure, and osmotic pressure is denoted by pi. The hydrostatic pressure is equal to h rho g, where h is height of the liquid column in the tube, rho is density, you all know this, and g is acceleration due to gravity. Now from this we have we are going to see some concepts. That is, the very first is isotonic solutions. Iso means same. Now two or more solutions having same osmotic pressure, they are said to be isotonic with each other. For example, 0.1 molar urea solution and 0.1 molar sucrose solution. Next is hypertonic and hypotonic. Hyper means more and hypo means less. So if two solutions have unequal osmotic pressure, the more concentrated solution with higher osmotic pressure is said to be hypertonic, and the more dilute solution exhibiting lower osmotic pressure is said to be hypotonic. Now, osmotic pressure of sucrose, for example, if you see here, osmotic pressure of sucrose solution is higher than that of urea solution. The sucrose solution is hypertonic to urea solution, and the urea solution is hypotonic to sucrose solution. Osmotic pressure and concentration of the solution. Now, osmotic pressure, that is pi. Pi is equal to N2 into RT divided by V, where V is the volume of the solution in dm cube containing N2 moles of the moles of the non-volatile solute. R is the gas constant, which is equal to 0.08206 dm cube atmosphere per Kelvin per mole, and pi is osmotic pressure in atmosphere. Van't Hoff factor I. From this we are going to see now what exactly is Van't Hoff factor, that is I, which is equal to colligative property of electrolyte solution divided by colligative property of non-electrolyte solution of the same concentration. Now, why colligative properties, they differ in case of electrolytes and non-electrolytes? Here I want to tell you one thing, that colligative properties, they depend upon the number and not on nature. It depends upon number of particles. In case of electrolytes, you all know that electrolytes, they dissociate nearly completely. So as a result of which, number of particles will be more. Whereas in case of non-electrolytes, they do not dissociate nearly completely, or they dissociate to a very, very less extent. So as a result of which, you can see that number of particles is less. So here, Van't Hoff factor I, which is equal to colligative property of electrolyte solution divided by colligative property of non-electrolyte solution of the same concentration. Or you can also say that Van't Hoff factor, it is a ratio. Ratio of what? Actual moles of particles in solution after dissociation divided by moles of formula units dissolved in the solution. Now see here, relation between Van't Hoff factor and degree of dissociation. Consider an electrolyte AxBy that dissociates in aqueous solution, as AxBy will dissociate as X molecules of Ay plus Y molecules of Bz minus. That is cations and anions, you can say positively charged and negatively charged. Now initially you have one mole of AxBy, and initially no molecule will dissociate. We have zero molecules of Ay plus and zero molecules of Bz minus. But at equilibrium, what will happen? One minus alpha moles of AxBy will dissociate, and X alpha moles of Ay minus and Y alpha moles of By minus getting dissociated. If alpha is the degree of dissociation of the electrolytes, then the moles of cations will be alpha X, you can see in the equation alpha X, and those of anions are alpha Y at equilibrium. Now we have dissolved just one mole of electrolyte initially. Alpha moles of electrolyte dissociate and 1 minus alpha mole remain undissociated at equilibrium. How much will dissociate? X alpha and Y alpha will dissociate, and how much is remaining undissociated? 1 minus alpha, because total we have taken 1 mole. So alpha getting dissociated, what else is left? 1 minus alpha is undissociated. So after total moles after dissociation will be how much? 1 minus alpha plus X alpha plus Y alpha. So that is equal to 1 plus alpha into X plus Y minus 1. So which is equal to 1 plus alpha into, you can see, N minus 1, where here you can see N is equal to X plus Y, which is equal to moles of ions obtained from dissociation of 1 mole of electrolyte. Fine. So what we already know, that I is equal to what? I is actual moles of particles in solution after dissociation divided by moles of formula units dissolved in solution. So which is equal to 1 plus alpha into N minus 1 divided by 1. Hence we have I is equal to 1. Here you can just cross multiply, and mathematically you can see I is equal to 1 plus alpha into N minus 1, or you can even see that alpha is equal to I minus 1 divided by N minus 1. See here again, in this derivation you have seen that total number of moles, total moles after dissociation, which is equal to 1 minus alpha plus X alpha plus Y alpha. So total adding you can see over here, which is equal to 1 plus alpha into N minus 1. So therefore we have I is equal to 1. You can say that I is equal to 1 plus alpha into n minus 1. And n is equal to what? X plus y. So moles obtained after obtained from dissociation of 1 mole of electrolyte. So I is equal to actual number of moles of particles in the solution after dissociation to the number of moles of formula units dissolved in the solution. So therefore number of moles dissolved will be 1 molar. We have taken 1 mole initially. See here, we have taken initially 1 mole of AXBY. So therefore we have 1 plus alpha into n minus 1 divided by 1. Hence we have I is equal to 1 plus alpha into n minus 1, or alpha is equal to I minus 1 divided by n minus 1. So this is with osmotic pressure and osmosis, a colligative property, the fourth colligative property that we have seen. So in this chapter we have seen certain laws. We have seen Henry's law, we have seen Raoult's law, we have seen all four colligative properties, that is lowering of vapor pressure, elevation in boiling point, depression in freezing point, and osmotic pressure. Prepare all four colligative properties properly. Prepare the go for those problems which are given behind the textbook. So also the certain solved problems, so that you will understand it properly. Solve the derivations again and again, so that so also go for the graphs. They are very important. With the graph you can understand the concepts clearly. Study properly. All the best.